friends, we are going to learn a new topic today in orthopedics. That is, just a minute, supracondylar fracture. I'm going to teach you about supracondylar fracture. Okay, when does a person... This is most common in children, if I have to say. This is more common in children. So, mechanism of action. So, what is the mechanism of supracondylar fracture? This occurs when the child falls on an outstretched hand, okay, and the hand strikes the ground. If the person is like this, he will... Just a minute. Yeah. Think that this is a boy and he will fall on an... This is his body and he will fall on an outstretched hand with hand touching the ground. So, this is the hand which is touching the ground. When this occurs, then there is... when the hand touches the ground, then the elbow becomes hyperextended. That results in fracture above the condyles. Just take an example. So, this is the thing. So, if the person falls on the hand, he will fall, and as a result, the elbow which is there, this becomes hyperextended, and as a result, this leads to a fracture above the condyles, above the epicondyles. That is called a supracondylar fracture. If I have to say, this is one, so it is something like this. Okay, so if you say, think this is the lower end of the humerus, the fracture is above the condyles. So, this is the fracture line. So, in the front view, this looks something like this. So, this supracondylar fracture is divided mainly into two types. One is the flexion type of supracondylar fracture. And the second type is extension type of supracondylar fracture. Extension type of supracondylar fracture is more common. So, in extension type of the supracondylar fracture, this is the proximal fragment. Think that if this is the elbow joint and this is the proximal fragment. Now, the distal fragment is tilted backwards. In extension type of supracondylar fracture, the distal fragment which is there, that distal fragment is twisted backward. So, this is what happens in extension type of supracondylar fracture. This is extension type, which is more common in 80%. In flexion type of supracondylar fracture, the proximal fragment is like this. Now, the distal fragment is tilted forward. So, this is the flexion type of supracondylar fracture, in which the proximal end or the distal end, it is twisted forward. It is tilted forward. So, if you see, this is the extension type of fracture which is seen in 80% of individuals, and this is flexion type of fracture which is seen in 20% of individuals. Now, there are certain displacements which can be seen in supracondylar fracture. Sometimes there can be either proximal or backward shift. This can be medial. There can be sometimes it can be associated with medial shift or proximal shift, or sometimes a medial tilt can be there. Any types of displacements can be possible. So these are the different types. Now, what does the patient come to you? The patient comes to us with a history of fall first, and then there will be pain at the site, and there will be swelling, and sometimes you can even see the deformity. And the patient is unable to move the shoulder joint because the shoulder joint is affected. As a result, there is inability to move the shoulder joint. If you examine here, you can see because there is a backward tilt. So, if you see, you can see an unusual prominence here. So, because of this backward tilt, you can see an unusual prominence at this stage, at this place. Here, you see unusual prominence on examination. Why is there? It is because of the backward tilt, and there is because of the tip of olecranon. Even because the tip of the olecranon, it is shifted backwards, and as a result, there is unusual prominence which you see. This is seen on examination. Okay, and then sometimes if the person presents late, there can be swelling. There can be cross swelling at this region. When there is cross swelling at this region, always and always look for radial and ulnar pulses, because it is the supracondylar region. Supracondylar fracture is just present above the elbow. The brachial artery will pass through it, so there can be brachial artery injury or brachial artery compression because of this fracture. That can result in nerve injury, or that can result in absence of pulses, and sometimes there can also be nerve injury. So nerve injury should also be looked for. Then you'll have to look for the x-rays. And then how are you going to diagnose it? Diagnosis, it is just through an x-ray. So there are different you'll have to order for an x-ray, which is the x-ray of the elbow joint should be done. So mostly both anterior posterior view and lateral view should be we should order for both anterior posterior and lateral view. So in the lateral view, you can sometimes find the displacement. Either it can be extension type of deformity can be found out, or flexion type of displacement can be found out, or sometimes there can be lateral or medial shifts. So, or sometimes it cannot be displaced. So I'm going to show you some x-rays where there is no displacement and there is some displacement. So this is one of the x-ray where, if you see, there is a fracture line here. Here, if you clearly observe, there is a fracture line. See, there is a fracture line here. Here, see. There is a fracture line, but there is no displacement. If you see, it's aligned properly. So this is undisplaced fracture. This is a type of undisplaced fracture. This is the anteroposterior view. This is the lateral view. In anteroposterior view, you cannot see anything. In fact, in lateral view, we can find out the fracture line. But this is undisplaced. I will even show you one more fracture, which is a displaced fracture. So this is a displaced fracture. You can clearly see the distal fragment is displaced backward. So what does it resemble? It resembles extension type of deformity. So if you see, this is the this is one more x-ray. So with the help of x-rays, you can identify the fractures clearly. Clearly, you can identify the fractures. And now, there is a classification for supracondylar fracture. It is present. That is called as Gartland classification. So what is Gartland classification? So according to Gartland classification, he classified supracondylar fractures into three types. Okay, according to type 1, if you see, there is the fracture, but there is no displacement. The fracture is present. Sorry. The fracture is present, but there is no displacement. You can just see a fracture line. So this is called as type 1 Gartner's fracture. Gartner's in either Gartner's classification, it is type 1 injury. And in type 2, if you see, there is displaced anterior wall. There is displaced, but most probably there is displaced anterior hinge wall, but the posterior hinge is not displaced. So this is type 2. Here only the anterior part is displaced, but not the posterior part. In type 3, it is completely displaced. Both anterior and posterior parts both are displaced. So these are the three types of Gartner's classification. Okay, now how are we going to treat the fracture? The treatment of the fracture, it mainly depends on whether the fracture is displaced or is it not displaced. Okay, if the fracture is displaced, okay, then if the fracture is not displaced, we will do only one thing. We will first immobilize it with an above elbow slab. We will make an above elbow slab. So this is the patient. So this is the hand. So here you will make an above elbow slab like this. Okay. So this is above elbow slab is made. Above elbow slab. Okay. This is made. If it is displaced, then first you will do a closed reduction. You will do a closed reduction and then you can do an internal fixation with K-wire. Okay, this is what we do if there is displacement. You'll have to first close it. You'll have to do closed reduction and then internal fixation with K-wire can be done. And you can also immobilize it with elbow slab and then you can do an internal fixation, or you can do an internal fixation and then immobilize it. In any way you can do. So how are you going to do a closed reduction? Closed reduction is done by three major steps. Okay, first let me just show you some diagrams which I have drawn. No, I'll draw them, that would be better. In closed reduction, first this is the arm. So the two surgeons, you know, one surgeon will hold the arm while the other surgeon will hold the forearm and they will extend it. Okay, like one, for example, I'm holding this and the other, my assistant will hold the other end and they will extend it. They will just give a traction like this, but the traction, they will not extend it completely. They'll just give a traction in such a way, in a flexed position. So we'll have to keep this elbow at 30 to 40 degrees Celsius flexed, and then you will have to apply traction in both the ends so that this displaced fragment, when you apply the traction, if this fragment is displaced, so once you apply the traction, once you have pulled it on both the sides, then the displaced segment, it will realign itself. Okay, so this is the main aim for it, so that this is corrected. That is first you do, where you do a traction. You will give a traction with elbow flexed at 30 to 40 degrees. That is the first step. Traction with elbow flexed at 30 to 40 degrees. Okay, then what do you do? Then you will just see. Then you will, if this is there, now you are going to flex it. Now the assistant will grab the hands on both the sides. Okay, both the hands like this. Okay, he is going to grab both the hands like this, while the surgeon, he will grasp the hand like this. And now, with the other hand, he is going to put on the olecranon process and slowly they will flex it. Now they are going to flex the elbow slowly. So this is called as flexion in traction. While they are doing this flexion in traction, the examiner will, the assistant, he will apply pressure over the olecranon process. So we have to apply pressure over olecranon. Okay, once you apply pressure on the over olecranon and once you are flexing the joint, you will flex the joint in this way. Okay, there are two things here. While doing this maneuver, always feel for radial pulse. Always and always feel for radial pulse. In some cases, the radial pulse will be present throughout the maneuver. In such case, bring the two elbows so close so that the olecranon gets locked. So that the joint here, this gets locked. Okay. So if at any stage there is decreased or absent radial pulse, if you have found that the radial pulse is absent after flexing for 80 to 90 degrees, the radial pulse is absent. At this stage, the radial pulse is absent. You can flex some more, but you're not able to flex it. When the radial pulse is absent at this stage, then you can do one thing. Just put an elbow slab at this stage itself. Now itself you are going to put an elbow slab. Okay, put the above elbow slab. When the pressure recurs, when the pulse recurs, see, these are the two elbows. Think that I'm just flexing them. Okay, And at this stage, the pulse is lost. Now I will just extend it a little so that the pulse returns, and then I will apply an above elbow slab here. Okay, when pulse appears on extension. Okay, so this is the thing which we do. When we flex here, then both these get locked, this elbow joint, the fragments get locked. As a result, there will be internal splint also. It acts as an internal splint. And as a result, we have to just apply a posterior slab for 3 weeks. For 3 weeks, you are going to apply this. And then you will have to do, always you will have to do a repeat x-ray. Check x-ray again after 48 weeks, 48 hours, and then 1 week. This is to know whether there is re-displacement or not. If there is re-displacement, then you will have to check for re-displacement. If there is no re-displacement, then remove after 48 weeks. Sorry, after 3 weeks. If there is re-displacement, then you will have to remove the slab and do open reduction and K-wire fixation. This is done. So these are the different treatment options which are available. So now, sometimes whenever there is fracture is re-displaced again, you can do open reduction and K-wire fixation. And if there is an open fracture, think that there is an open fracture. The fracture is open. The wound is open. In such case, do not attempt any reduction. You will have to do open reduction and K-wire fixation. And if there is any injury to the brachial artery, here there is always brachial artery. If there is any injury to this brachial artery, even then, always and always do injury to brachial artery. Or if there is open wound, in such cases, you will have to always attempt open reduction and internal fixation. Never, never try to do any other thing. There is one more technique which is not used now, but it is available. This is called as continuous traction. Okay, so this is how we use a slab. So this is the slab, if you see. So here we have put a slab, and after immobilization and putting a slab, you can visualize it on x-ray, and then later you can use K-wires for fixation. Okay, now the techniques which are not used now are of two types. One is called as Smith's traction, and the other is Dunlop's traction. In Smith's traction, we put a K-wire through the olecranon. So this is Smith's traction, in which here through the olecranon fossa, we are putting an external traction, which is by passing a K-wire through the olecranon. So this is a K-wire, we have passed it through the olecranon, and we are giving the traction. So this is Smith's traction. And the second type of traction is Dunlop's traction. So this is Dunlop's traction. Here we are giving traction to the skin. If you see here, there is skin. This is a below elbow skin traction. Below elbow skin traction. So this is the traction which you give. That is below elbow skin traction, which is Dunlop's traction. And in Smith's traction, we pass a K-wire through olecranon. I think you have understood it. So these are the different types of tractions which are available. So this is Dunlop's traction and then skin traction. Okay, so these are the different treatment options which are available for supracondylar fracture. Now there are complications. Complications, they are of different types. It can be immediate complication or late complication. If it is immediate complication, it can be injury to the artery. First, as I have said, that is brachial artery. Whenever there is injury to the brachial artery, the most common thing is if the presentation is delayed, then there is development of collaterals around the brachial artery. And thus, this will salvage the limb. Or else, sometimes because of the injury to the brachial artery, the flexor muscles, brachial artery generally supplies the flexor muscles of the forearm. So those flexor muscles of the forearm, all those may undergo Wolfman's ischemia. Generally, it also supplies the back of the forearm, but the back of the forearm there is collateral supply. But in the front of the forearm, the artery supplied is anterior interosseous artery, which is a branch of brachial artery, which is an end artery. So, as a result, this will not salvage. So, injury to the artery and injury to the nerve can occur. Has immediate complications. If it is early complications, there can be Volkmann's ischemia. And if it is late complications, there can be malunion, myositis ossificans, and Volkmann's ischemic contracture. We will learn about all of them in our next class. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubts, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.